To set the stage, I want to refer to some recent work, not in technology, but international trade, by David Auder and his colleagues. David's a labor economist at MIT, and they did a bunch of work on the very rapid increase in imports from China that occurred after China was admitted to the World Trade Organization in 2000. Over the last 15 years or so, Chinese imports grew from about 2% of U.S. imports to about 18% of U.S. imports. And it happened so fast that it really overwhelmed and devastated a number of communities. And it will not surprise you that in a post-election appendix to this work, David showed that, in fact, those districts voted heavily for Donald Trump. There were significant shifts in voting patterns compared to earlier elections for that. I think it's fair to say that David's work took many economists by surprise. Economists hadn't really been keeping tabs at how fast Chinese imports were increasing, and of course they didn't have much face-to-face contact with those communities, and so it was really a kind of miss the ball and asleep at the switch on the part of economists. Since the election, of course, we are paying a lot more attention, because one of the major points in Donald Trump's campaign was the fact that government policy could limit the flow of imports if you did it right. Forget about whether that's true or not. The message had a lot of resonance. It's shown by the post-election voting patterns. Now, the Auder work is relevant. David's work is relevant to this conference because, at least at the current level, technology and trade are affecting many of the same occupations. It's easy to give a number of simple examples. You think about assembly line work. A lot of it is roboticized, but a lot more of it is also offshored. If you think about basic tax returns being sent to junior accountants in India or being done by TurboTax and tax cuts. If you think about call center work being offshore to India and the Philippines, heavily scripted work, and then you think about call center work being handled increasingly by automated speech recognition and sort of cognitive systems. So I take two points away from this. First, we should expect that rapid expansion of computers in the workplace, when and if it occurs, should have the same social and political implications that we've seen with the rapid expansion of Chinese imports. That is to say, we shouldn't be talking about this as if it's all going to take place in a stable political environment, because I don't think there's much reason to believe that's true. And so for that reason, the second point is that it's particularly important that we not be asleep at the switch again, and we understand just where we are in this process of technical evolution. This is particularly true since in most cases, there's nothing that corresponds to imposing a 35% tariff to slow down the spread of technology when it does get going. The purpose of this session is to explore these kinds of issues. We have three very distinguished people who have thought a lot about it. I could take the next half hour telling you how distinguished they are, but I think you can read that for yourselves, and there's probably more important things we should be doing here. Let me just introduce them now. Dick Freeman is professor of economics at Harvard University, which is also known as the Rice University of the Northeast. He has been recognized as a leading scholar of labor markets, essentially since he got his PhD in 1969. Larry Mischel is president of the Economic Policy Institute in Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. is also known as the Houston of the Mid-Atlantic region. Under Larry's leadership, the Economic Policy Institute has become the go-to source for accurate data on the conditions of U.S. workers and the way those conditions are shaped specifically by government policy. In today's world of fake news stories from both home and abroad, the importance of EPI as a kind of source of facts, which I know are getting a little bit déclassé, has become just increasingly important. And third speaker is Diane Bailey, who is an associate professor at the School of Information at the University of Texas at Austin, which is also known as the University of Texas at Austin. Diane is a rare scholar who studies how a technology's impact is conditioned by the organization in which it functions. This is very subtle work, and it requires mastering two disciplines, both what technology is doing and how organizations behave and shape the technology that goes on within them. The reward for putting in all this work is that you get a much richer picture of what's going on. It's not just a kind of simplistic model of technological determinism. We're going to deviate slightly from the program. Rather than have Larry and Richard each give a 40-minute talk, they're going to each talk for 30 minutes, and then there's going to be about 20 minutes for the two of them to interchange with each other in the audience. Michelle's going to keep all this on track, so we won't go over anything, but I think it'll turn out to be a richer discussion. So, Richard, why don't you begin?
Do I move the switch, or you guys make the switch? The machine, the screen? It's here. Okay, there we go. Okay, so this is what I'm going to be talking about. The key word in this is income, because most of the popular thing you see is loss of jobs, and then you've got two little slides about the job situation. And if you apply just a pretty standard economic analysis, it's going to be about the income people get. People are pretty flexible, and when they have to do things to live, you know, in some countries, kids are on the streets selling coat hangers so they can get a meal. So people will do things to do this. And I've got four points, and the fourth will be some kind of solution to what I see as the problem. Oops, now I better just see how this goes. Okay, so first I just start off with a simple question. First part of the question, to search the law library, comes to me from the former president of Harvard and dean of the Harvard Law School, Derek Bach. He calls me up one day and says, let's have lunch. He's retired in Florida. And he says, what do you think about this? I don't need any law students to work on my new book. I just have the LexisNexis. I have the Harvard thing. And what's going to happen to those law students? Bang. For the others, you can just go down and see which case you would put A or which case you would put B. As a professor, I worry about, to learn about Feynman diagrams, if I was a Physics 1 lecturer, or if Richard Feynman had a MOOC that does it, which would people choose? And indeed, at Harvard, we have had some faculty who refuse the MOOCs because people will indeed not show up to their 8 o'clock in the morning classes, and they'd rather just watch it, et cetera. Obviously, the life and death go match you know about. The more interesting one is spending Mardi Gras weekend in New Orleans. And I think for the moment, most people would choose B, although some of you may choose A, but the one thing we haven't had any real discussion of is the social robots being created by the Japanese, who clearly seem to have a preference not for a someone cleaning your house, not for a nurse imported from the Philippines, but to have a machine doing the work. The last one is very new, and we'll see how successful it is. It uses IBM Watson. And so the presentation this morning on the Watson was just great. This is workers in Walmart cannot unionize. Walmart will close stores before they would allow American workers to unionize. So the workers have come up with a scheme to have an app that they can is downloadable, where they can have discussions and advice from Watson about how to deal with a workplace problem. If you don't have an old-fashioned union, it means you don't have shop floor stewards, you don't have the money to have a hierarchical organization. There are four people in this, quote, startup organization. We will see how they do. So in all different kinds of places, we see the computers either be, they could be our assistant here, but of course, if every student at Rice had a Watson assistant, would they need the professors that much at all? The assistant gives them the advice. So it's an interesting question. So I just say, here's just everywhere, including one from Moshe. These are headlines. The one that shook me up two weeks ago was UNCTAD is some UN agency, which declared that robots would take away 2/3 of jobs in developing countries. I'm going to say that the economics says this is not the thing to be afraid of. Will they steer it? Will they steal? Dot, dot, dot. It's a whole set of, that's what we see. And I haven't mapped or categorized, or sort of counted, but my sense is it's just a zooming curve. And I should have done that, but I didn't. And then for your work, well, there's a McDonald's in Phoenix. There's coffee. There's a dishwasher. Dishwashers are very hard for a robot, so I don't know how that one could possibly do it, but I don't know. It does, and you just go down the list of things. And a cop on the beat may be a bot. You know, for some people, maybe they would feel safer if it was a robot than if it was a normal a person in blue. And I want to think about, looking backward, we've seen these fears of the job loss. I went back to the Great Depression, and I quoted President Roosevelt, which the Great Depression, by anybody's rationality, had nothing to do with technology. But he was blaming it, the surplus of our labor, which the efficiency of the industrial processes did. We know that that was not a correct explanation, because along came World War II, and with great demand, everybody and people who never had jobs got jobs. There was a movement then by engineers, technocracy movement, which thought they should replace markets with planning by engineers. So be it. There was the scare in the 1960s. And the Kennedy and Johnson administration set up a commission of very distinguished economists to look at this. And then not so long ago, Jeremy Rifkin declared the end of work. And that was before the dot-com boom came along and created all kinds of jobs. So there's some suspicion among economists that all of this becomes a bit of a blame technology for failures of economic policy and other things. And I think that's an element of truth to that. The key concept for understanding why this is more of an income problem than an employment problem is the concept of a comparative advantage. So I picked an example. You may know who The Rock is. He was a professional wrestler and a movie star. And you're the better scientist than he is. So he ends up making hundreds of millions wrestling and in the movies, and you do your scientific research. But maybe he's a better scientist than you too. But if he's just a bit better scientist than you, it makes no sense for him to spend his little time doing science and giving up a juicy movie role or another championship in the wrestling ring. That's the point of comparative advantage. So if you compare the human against the best machine you have, the machine will not be able to do everything better than a human. Or you could phrase it the other way around. There's some things in which, even if the machine dominated across the boards, the human has a comparative advantage and would still be able to do. So that is a principle that says we should not really put so much attention on the employment scare. People will find something to do. And then the question is, and here I made it clear, specialized AI robots, and there's the AlphaGo and the Google DeepMind. And the one thing that they did use a human in that Go tournament was to move the pieces. So that's the kind of thing you could imagine us doing. If the machine has all the right answers, and I might personally, knowing something about doctors, prefer them to have a real medical assistant telling them, don't forget this, don't forget that, don't forget the other thing, because a lot of doctors do forget what they've learned, and they may not be keeping up with the literature either. So about there'll be places for humans, even if it's just moving those pieces, and the question then becomes, well, what are we going to be paid for that, et cetera? Now, I went back to one of my favorite economists, which is Herb Simon, and obviously one of the founders of sort of a lot of the machine things. And this was the book that I used to teach my graduate students about, which follows the very much the normal. Technology, Herb said, benefits the factor of production, meaning labor or capital, which is less elastic supply. As long as you run a full employment economy, if you have a very elastic supply, you don't gain, the price doesn't change. If you're inelastic, like this, and the demand increases because you're in a growing economy, the incomes go up. And this is, he was very good, one of the rare economists who would always have a little bit of evidence to guide what he was thinking about. Some of us don't need any evidence. We have the invisible hand, which is present someplace, telling us. So he first said, how do I know this? This is 1966. This is when the Johnson and Kennedy administration were studying the problem, and he gave the most intelligent answer. He said, well, hey, wait, we got low unemployment, and we've had technical change for years. Why should we worry? Then he said, look, the capital, the machine, I'll use the word robots as a code word for any form of capital, because it's really machines and capital income. And he said, we look over history, the real price of capital is relatively constant. So that's the elastic supply. And then the beneficiaries of technical change therefore had to be the workers. And either their real wages go up because prices fall from the new goods and services, or they get higher wages. And he noted that real wages increased with productivity. And that was the reality through the, I would say, 1970. We now, and here's his quote here, which I thought was great, the world's problems are, in this generation and the next, are problems of scarcity, not of intolerable abundance, et cetera. We shouldn't worry about automation taking everybody's job. And now, the missing points, right? I think the evidence goes in the other direction that he would rethink. After teaching this for a number of years, I stopped teaching this, as this is the way to look at technology. And this is, what is missing is, there was never any discussion of who owns the capital, which is very important. Because if capital income is good, is high, and a few people own it, and capital keeps increasing, those few people are getting to be richer and richer and richer. And then the AI and robotization part is, I think it's fair to say, though I haven't measured this, I'm not sure how one would measure it. I suppose we could think of some ways to do this with some robotics, that every robot is getting closer and closer to the human in some of their capabilities. Not in our full capabilities, because the Go robot could not beat me in chess. It could not beat me in anything except Go. And I'm not a particularly good Go player. Any Korean student can beat me, I'm sure. In economics, the term is the elasticity of substitution. Because when two things are very substitutable, then essentially having more of the other thing reduces the price, the way earnings of this thing. This is one of the two things left out of Simon's analysis. And the reason he, I'll just say without having spoken to him about this, but the reason he would have left them out was labor's share of income was constant. There was no evidence that capital was getting an advantage over labor. And wages rose with productivity, real wages. They just went one-to-one, I mean, literally. Somewhere before, depending on what he meant by in this generation and the next, but it's somewhere in the 70s, that stopped. And we now have the situation, which was Moshe showed on one of the very earliest slide, the incomes are not rising and productivity is. You didn't put the slide that has labor's share is falling in the US and capital's share is rising. So that changes my views of this. And what I want to just tell us, what Simon was doing was Malthus had had this prediction, because people just had many, many babies, that the elastic supply was humans. And he predicted we'd all be near starvation, because he just produced babies, and there'd be more babies. And as the babies went to the labor market, the wages would be driven down. And you know, it has a logical thing. He didn't, what proved him wrong was people stopped having that many babies. I said the AI and the robots turns the Malthus inside out. Maybe I should have said turns Simon upside down. That would probably fit more of the talk. And I put a quote here from an economist, which sort of mimics what Malthus said to what I think is the case today. And robot competition must, in some shape or other, visit the human race. That we are going to have an increased problem, but the problem is not going to be jobs. It's going to be more the Pennsylvania dean and. Said maybe it's in the middle level jobs where people will be pushed and they can't get up to the top jobs, and you can't have everybody in the top jobs. That doesn't work. So I think we will have a problem. So I, for following Isaac Asimov, I believe, I wrote down my laws of robot economics. And you can see them. The first thing was, which I don't really have evidentiary proof, but it just seems to me to be the case, that there's just more substitutability between machines and humans than we had before. And that just means that whereas you normally would say more machines per person increases wages, if the machines, in fact, are doing this basically the same thing as the humans, that is the equivalent of trade with China, or where it's other human beings that we're trading with, et cetera. Two is that over time, the great work of the people working on robotics things, the cost of the robot substitutes for people goes down. And if that cost goes down, that puts a bounds on the wage of people. No one's going to be paid more for a particular task than what's the production cost of the robot substitute. Now the machines, they do very specific things. So you need thousands of them doing thousands of tasks to where people will have troubles, finding a decent job. Phrase it that way. And then my bottom line was: it's who owns the assets, who owns the robots? I said rules the world. And I always think about this as if I have my Watson helper here, and I own it, and it's helping me. That's great. It improves my productivity and my income. If he owns it, and then IBM has suddenly said, what do we need him for? We could have the robot assistant on somebody else, and maybe it's even somebody's robot, et cetera. Who knows? So it's very critical that people, society, owns these technologies. So then there was a great quote I found someplace on artificial intelligence: will be split into a handful of gods and the rest of us. And the handful of gods are the billionaires who would own these technologies. That was a report by a major bank that said this. I'm sure the bankers thought of themselves as being on the god side. So now I'm just going to conclude with a solution in some sense, or part of a solution. And I think it is that we have to establish institutions and means that we own more of these technologies. And that means more of capital. The inequality in the U.S. is twofold. One, it's threefold. One, it is that capital share is rising. And if there's a big recession, it'll go down again. But there seems to be a trend rise over the last 20, 30 years, maybe longer. There's rising inequality among workers. But the inequality among workers includes incomes at the top. And guess what CEOs and top executives are paid? They're not paid in normal wages or salaries. They're paid in parts of capital income. So there's that kind of issue. And then capital income itself has become more unequally distributed. So it all leads to a small number of people having incredible wealth, which they can influence. I went back to the founders of the US, and the American Revolution had deep in its heart a feeling that equality among people was critical for the success of democracy. So I got here's all these quotes from characters. Hamilton, he's a show now in New York. But the idea, independent proprietor. All of these guys were about land. And you know, I'll give you in a minute all the laws that we've passed to do this. But land, you know, one out of 200, I forgot the exact number that was given on the farmers, but 2% of Americans do farming. Land is not gonna do it. It has to be business capital. And so there has to be some greater, wider ownership of that if we're gonna avoid these problems. Then I give two other quotes that just reflect this incredible concern that the founders of our country had, that if inequality reached a certain level, the democracy was done. This is both are from James Madison, who is, as far as I can see, by far he's the most intellectual and smartest of the founders. And you can just read that. The first is a bifurcated model, and you can write down differential equations if you like to do that. That would give you these kind of things. And it's when people no longer have an ownership stake in the society, which they saw as ownership through land, they will unite and become dupes and instruments of ambition, which basically meant the French Revolution kind of things, or their poverty will render them mercenary instruments of wealth, meaning saying, yes, Mr. Big, I do whatever you say. Or Mrs. Big, who's ever got the money. And then he goes on and says, in one case, we'll have despotism out of anarchy, in the other, oligarchy founded on corruption, which I think is actually more likely in this country. And then he went on and talked about what Washington and regulations, and just that in, this is the Federalist Papers, this is a long time ago, the same kind of stuff that you see going on. So the idea being that if inequality passes a certain point, there really a democratic society cannot function well, and God knows what, you know, there's some predictions there. This country has passed bill after bill at different times in order to redistribute or distribute property more evenly. The first one was one for the people of New England. The Brits had destroyed the cod fishery, which was a big industry. And the codfish owners went and said, give us tax credits and things so we can rebuy build new boats. And the Washington said, only if the profits are shared with your workers. And they actually had a number, which I've forgotten. It's 5/9 or 4/9. One went to the owners and one went to the workers. And that was the rule, that you don't get any money unless you do that. Northwest Ordinance was basically free land with no slavery in parts of it. Louisiana Purchase was Jefferson's famous thing, done so that there'd be enough land to keep the democracy going. Lincoln's Homestead Act was the biggest government giving, granting at low prices or freely to immigrants who were coming, or could be anybody, but many of it went to immigrants, et cetera. ERISA is a law I'll talk a little bit more afterwards, was in, I think it was 1976, what, 67, yes, thank you. In which we enacted a law that favored workers owning parts of their own company. They're called ESOPs, Employee Stock Ownership Plans, and the Alaska Fund, and actually the amounts that they paid, I checked that, it's $2,000 to every citizen in Alaska. That's a distribution of government monies because it's public lands. Everybody gets the same amount. This year it was less because oil prices must have fallen, or the stock market, who knows why, it's $1,000. dollars. So we have a history of doing this. And the Alaska policy, of course, was put in with support from conservative Republicans. And you can get Sarah Palin saying how wonderful it is. But it means everybody is sharing in the capital wealth. Okay, let me go next. Whoops. Oh, then I have a book to sell, which lays out a lot of these things about with the two colleagues. And so the solution, citizens own more capital, your robot working for you, and a robot, a Roomba, in every house. Somebody said the Roomba robot. There are some competitors, though. I don't know which is the best for cleaning that. So what are these citizens' shares that we talked about? The two parts. One, it is under the ESOPs, and 15 million American workers work in ESOP companies. That's 10% of our workforce. So this is not a weird left-wing or right-wing thing off to the corner. It's actually a substantial part of the US economy. Those companies did much better through the recession. They showed much greater responsibility to their workers. It would be fascinating to see how they voted in this election, who knows. And it occurs through company matching funds. There are tax breaks involved, so companies do this, but it's there. People get stock options that mostly goes to the high executives, but every single one of the Silicon Valley firms, and I'm sure IBM has stock options for lots of people. Google does, I know. Microsoft does, any place where you want everybody on board working together, and there's just evidence that that leads to better company performance. And then there's this profit sharing, which is, and lots of companies do that explicitly and some do it implicitly. We actually are ahead of the rest of the world in this form of capitalism. And then the other mechanism is, of course, people own, their pension funds own shares. And then we have the sovereign funds. So that's the solutions. So I then said, this is propaganda. If citizens own robots, you see this, I don't know, James Madison or somebody, that there's a bunch of young college students having a blast. They're slightly older now and they're doing fine wine. And then if not, this is a great thing. We're not for everyone, just the 1% that matters. And you see the statements at the bottom, and it is extremely, then you say the upper 0.1%, the upper 0.01%. If you look at the income statistics, you see extraordinary. So I'm a multimillionaire, and I look across over there, and that billionaire is way ahead of me. No, its inequality has grown at the very top massively. I mean, it's so massive that if you look, the IRS publishes on the internet, if you look IRS top 400 taxpayers, you will see their share of the income of the US from 1992 to 2015. Or 14 or 13, I've forgotten the last year. It's always a few years, I think it's 2013, actually. It has gone up astoundingly. The top 400 people get, I don't know, 13% of capital gains, 10% of dividend income. And just as a matter of things, the whole number of people paying taxes has gone up. The top 400 is a limited group. So as their share of taxpayers has been going down, their share of the income has gone up. And it's an amazing kind of the statistic to see. And you understand that the very top, a very small number of people. I got to brush my time. I'm done. That's good. Okay.